But I want to also thank Roger for putting this program together. It was his idea. It was a great idea. And to remember Mr. Berman and Mr. Pitkin's historical figures in the way they gave for many years. And we appreciate the word volunteer and the dedication from them. So at this point, I want to say welcome again. Enjoy the program. And I'm going to turn over to Roger. He's going to be a little more specific on some of the aspects of it.
Okay, well, we're here because of the number one, the river. Bardo Boatwork, which is Westbury's, and then also they planted a lot of willow trees there. And so, you know, that was like 1925, so obviously, so the willows are kind of getting over. So if you look around, you can still see some down there, you know, towards Bardo's actually.
And so the intent was basically everyone loves the water's edge. And whether you fish or whether you stare, you would just swim onto the water's edge. And so the concept is that basically there's an existing willow here. I call it another willow and another willow. You can only find one willow in Western Michigan. So therefore, the willows over there are closer to the river. The sycamore tree, which you'll see them together in the park, is also one of the basically at the opportunity for an opening, right straight through there, and maybe a park bench or something like that. And, you know, Becky was involved in just creating that wonderful gazebo at the end of Colbert Park. And that we have another opportunity to kind of create some of our natural settings for that scene thing. So, we'll have, Ben to say something and also Lois to say something. So Ben Berman, ladies first, Ben, I don't know, ladies first. Okay, so and, you know, we don't have a speaker system, so maybe we have to move in or whatever. But Lois is going to talk about
that. I don't have that big a voice. But anyway, we're here today to honor two very important people in our area to visit. A place to live and to work. And through that, he was he sort of started a life of public service. He was on the council, he was in the Chamber of Commerce, and he, especially the Tourist Bureau. He was a member of the White Lake Yacht Club, and I have a copy of the old issue from 1961, the year that he died, and he had written this for many, many years. Interesting publication, not only dealt with yacht club activities, but the town as well. And I'd like to read a couple of excerpts from the obituary that's written in here. He had written the whole thing, it over to King's brother to, well, he didn't turn it over. It happened to go to him when he died, and Ken's brother published it. So I'd like to just read a little bit. Clarence Pitkin was born September 28, 1893, in Whitehall, and graduated from the local school in 1912. He then went to the University of Michigan Pharmacy School, where he graduated in 1915. He married Edith Quackenbush, who had been a fellow student and a member of his class in high school, and then he joined his father in the drugstore. In the middle 20s, he and Dave Dahlstrom took over the older Pitkin's interest in the drugstore, and Clarence embarked on a career in public service for his community, which had taken care of him. When the Yacht Club was reorganized, Clarence founded the Yacht Club News, which became his major interest, in which he used to help promote
sewer systems, for streets, for street lighting, for better transportation, better docking, and better city parks, and for the city recreation systems. He had a summer recreation program for summer visitors, for the greater public appreciation of the wonders of Western Michigan. He served a term on the city council, was active all his life in the Chamber of Commerce, and was instrumental in periodic facelifting of the business district as well as the resorts around the lake. He's lived here and wintered in Florida, and his love was the White Lake area. And so I think you agree with me that it's only right and proper that we honor such a man in the community that he loved. Thank you.
He was born in 1903, graduated from Muskegon High School, and then went to Northwestern University in Chicago, where he graduated from the School of Journalism. He worked for the Sun-Times in Chicago for a couple of years, and then came back to Muskegon, and worked for the Muskegon Chronicle for a reporter for a number of years. 1935, he bought the Whitehall Forum and used the forum to do what he could to improve the White Lake community. He was a very intelligent guy and a very visionary guy. He was the one that was primarily responsible for Whitehall changing from the village to a city. He was the one who promoted the paving of Whitehall streets, development of the sewer system and the sewage disposal plant. I remember as a kid watching CCC guys dig the trenches for the sewer system by hand. He was on the school board for a number of years. During the time he was on the school board was when they consolidated, brought in the Lakewood and White Lake school districts to be part of the Whitehall school system. As such, he got quite involved in education. Gave numbers of speeches, and I don't remember the year, I think it was probably President Eisenhower appointed him to the Commission on Education. In that capacity, he gave speeches to Rotary clubs and school boards and another around the country. He was, many of you older folks remember the Swedish Festival. He was one of the prime organizers of the Swedish Festival. He wrote the script for the pageant that was put on, and worked with the psychologist, with Sigurd from the Swedish Church, and it's a whole song. In 1960, after he acquired the Whitehall Forum, he acquired three other papers over time. It was the Tri-City Labor Review and Muskegon Heights Record. And then finally, when Fred Wagner retired, he bought the Montague Observer, the Whitehall Forum and the Observer. Purchased by Harold Bennett from Dad in 1966. 1961, head at the request of John Hinn, came to Michigan State to reform and fix up student newspapers and what is called State Journal, I guess. Anyway, he took the journal out of Munger Journalism, incorporated as a nonprofit organization. In the first year, he took it from in the red to in the black. In the 11 years that he was general manager of the paper, they won 10 Pacemaker Awards as one of the best student newspapers in the country. He retired in 1972. The caricature illustration there was done by Phyllis Crane when Dad retired from Michigan State. I do have a picture here that some of you have.
One quick one. Al Vanderpool has been attorney in town for a lot of years, city attorney. He always told me that Louis Berman was the reason he was here. When he left Skegan practice, he was looking for a place. Louis set him up in his office, took him to the bank, got him a loan. Yeah, he said, I didn't have to do much. Louis took care of him.
Well, I was thinking of, I'm writing a book about medicine, so I have two stories about Louis Berman, and there's every one of them. So do you want to hear about castor oil, or do you want to hear about Dr. Collier?
Either one.
Collier was a rather gruesome ending.
Well, Dr. Collier was. But I'll do the castor oil story. I didn't know either man, but sort of know them vicariously because they're sort of part of the history. Apparently, after he was born in Muskegon, the Berman family moved to Chicago. My story grew up in a tenement in Chicago. And the story goes, it had to do with castor oil. He and his cousin, about 6 years old, and they were living in this tent, the second story, and playing dumpster. That is, they had this clamshell contraption on the end of a steep string. They knock it, put it down to the ground, and pick up whatever junk was down there, bring it back up again. And who knows what was there? But anyway, later that day they got sick, and Grandma always had one cure for sickness of any sort, and that was a large tablespoon of castor oil. And of course, neither one would take the stuff because they had had it before. And so it got to bribery. Finally, the parents and Grandma bartered them up to 5 cents for the kings, and they finally relented. The moral of the story is that life is too precious to give it away. Castor oil, even for 5 cents at the can. The story's about the Pitkin plant. Again, they're in there too because of the this other stuff. But the story that I always liked most about Clarence Pitkin was that if you came from anywhere around here, didn't dare go in the store. Clarence was always there with a little tag, and he would just pin you to the wall and then glean anything out of it possible. You might be able to put in into the which is just as a wonderful positive. I mean, it's not big news. It's just the thing that goes on of the place. And it's what keeps people together. But he would then just take it out of me, just pull it out of me, and then I would find it. And in either case, it's just amazing. The one did a monthly, the other did a weekly. And they did it with practically no staff. What the hell? I mean, today, I work hard to get a book out in 2 or 3 years using word processing and formatting on a computer. These guys did it every week or every month. And they had to use old-fashioned photography. They had to use old-fashioned line type. How did they ever do anything else? And yet they both did.
He did tell me that many of you will remember the hospital fund that was developed, and it appeared to Louis, and I know some other men, I just can't name them. I think one of them might have been Russ Kleinfeld, felt that that a hospital would not be built here. So, and the monies were sitting, they've been donated. And so he was instrumental through the Muskegon Community Foundation, which existed, to develop the White Lake Community Fund. And that's what I remember, especially in talking about that hospital fund and getting it back into the community. I know a lot of people were upset at the time that a hospital wasn't going to be built here, but in time, certainly the community fund has helped over and over again.
The origin of all that had to do with the occurrence in the 50s, I think. Neither Muskegon Hospital had a real emergency ward. They had a place to take people during the day, but they had nothing in the evening. So somebody from the White Lake area had a child who became deadly ill and took him out of the school. Couldn't find anybody to accept him. And the child died. And that became a big issue. And so Louis, through the newspaper, wrote a scathing editorial attacking the hospital and the AMA, the local chapter of the AMA. Why don't you get this? And they got some action. I mean, eventually both hospitals created a real emergency ward with a real doctor nurses. But in the meantime, that's why they thought of a hospital locally, because at least if you couldn't get into the scheme,
this is it. There's no one else that wants to. This is good. Large amounts of people aren't always great. Okay.
Wait, stay here, guys.
Okay. If, right here. Okay.
Gosh, I can't see a thing. Gosh, it's too far away.
So, as soon as everyone has pictures, this is the Bourbon Church.
He was hiding. He was hiding
behind Sandra.
Okay. One more. Okay.
Yes, you did a good job. Yes. Now we got a wagon, yeah.
good Scott. Okay. I know you don't see much of me. I hide.
Okay. Everyone like look right up here. Three, one, two. Oops. Okay.
One, two, whoops.
Ruth, if you could move the shovel a little bit to your left so it's not in your face. Okay.
Yeah. Great. That's where we had a little bit. Got a shaft.
There you go. Okay. We'll do it on three here. One, two, three. So I'm on recording.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. I got your good side.
Okay. One, two, three. Good.